In this video, we'll walk through how you can connect and query your Snowflake database directly through SQL Server. So as you can see, I'm here in my Snowflake environment, and what we'll want to do is go to Help, Download, and then in our case, we want the ODBC driver, and we'll select Snowflake repository. It'll open up a new tab here, and in my case, I want the 64-bit Windows, so I'll select that, latest, and we'll download this file. This is going to be the driver, the ODBC driver, that's compatible with Snowflake that we can put on our computer. I'll go ahead and save this, and when it's done, go ahead and open it. You may get this message that, you know, just kind of giving you a heads up that it's an executable. That's okay. So I'll go ahead and click OK. And now we'll walk through this wizard. Pretty straightforward. Next, you can select a location to save it. Next, and install. That's it. Okay, so now this is complete. And now the next step is to add a new ODBC source to our machine that points to Snowflake. To do that, let's go to search here. I'm on Windows and we'll do ODBC. And in my case, I did the 64-bit, so I'll click this. Now you can add this data source for just a particular user that you're on, or you can do it for the entire system, which is what we'll do here. So go to System DSN, and you'll see I have the 32-bit installed from a previous video, but don't worry about this here for now. We're gonna go through the steps to add a new one. Select Add, and we'll select the Snowflake driver that we just installed. Finish. Now here, we're going to configure this data source to point to our particular Snowflake environment. This first box here, data source, is what the actual name of the data source is going to be, you know, as you refer to it once we get to SQL Server. Here you can see for this old one, I called this Snowflake, so I'll call this one, I'll just call it Snowflake as well. And all this here is going to be based on your particular environment, so I'll go ahead and fill this out. In terms of server, all you need here is from your account number to snowflakecomputing.com. You don't need HTTPS or anything else, so select copy, and we'll paste that here. For database and schema, in this example, we'll primarily look at this here, this Fivetran database, Google Sheets. So I'll go ahead and put that in here. But this will obviously be based on what you're working with. Google Sheets, warehouse, I'm going to do the compute warehouse. Role, I'm going to do account admin just so there's no permissions issues, but obviously, like anything else with Snowflake, you'll likely create a very specific role or something like this and, you know, lock it down a bit more. Tracing, we won't get into this too much. I'll just say 4 for this. Select OK. So now we can see here we've added this 64-bit data source called Snowflake using this driver. OK. Now here we are in SQL Server Management Studio, and our next step is to create a linked server that uses that new data source, that ODBC data source that we just created, to point to our Snowflake environment. To do that, we'll go down to Server Objects, and here is Linked Servers. We can see there's a bunch of providers, and one of the steps we actually need to take here in order for this to work is right here with this MSD ASQL provider. Go ahead and right click on that. This is a specific requirement here. Now we see here that the only thing selected here is allow in processes. And for this to work correctly with Snowflake here, what we want to do is select a few more. So go ahead and select nested queries, level 0 only, and supports like operator. So it should look like this when you're all done. 1, 2, 3, 4. Click OK. Now what we want to do is actually add a new linked server. So to do that, we can right click here and say new linked server. Now we have this pretty standard Windows wizard here, and we'll walk through this each step of the way here. So here, the linked server, this is the name the linked server will be referenced by. We'll call this Snowflake Test. Now you could create a linked server to another SQL Server instance, but in our case, what we're going to do is select other data source, because our data source is going to be using that ODBC data source that we just created. For provider, so we'll drop down here and say Microsoft OLEDB for ODBC drivers. Select that guy. Now, product name. Product name is the data source to add as the link server. You can just match it to what you have here. So we'll call this Snowflake Test. And then really what's important is the data source here. As it says, the system DSN of ODBC data source. So this actually has to be a system DSN. Now we see this here. Before we saw there was that user and system option. It must be a system DSN. And what we called it was just Snowflake, if you recall. That was that first config attribute there. So we'll call Snowflake. And this will let SQL Server know that it should look on our system for a DSN, ODBC DSN called Snowflake. Okay, next is security. And here what we'll do is go for a login. We'll select be made using this security context. And again, we're going to add our Snowflake username and password. So I'll do mine and press okay. Now it's going to try to create this. And if you didn't get any errors here, that's a good sign. That means it was able to establish that connection. Now at this point, we have a linked server on our SQL Server instance that is pointing actually to Snowflake. Pretty cool. And just to verify that everything is good here, you can right click and do test connection. And we can see test connection to the link server succeeded. I'm gonna open up a file that has a few queries here. And the way we're going to do this is using the open query function within SQL Server. So what this will do is select all from open query. Right here is the name of the link server. So in our case, we called it Snowflake Test. So whatever you called it, you would put here. And here is where you're going to pass the actual query that you want. So I know it says select all here, but this is the query that will be run on Snowflake. So just to give you a little preview of what this looks like, I'm going to select run. And here's what it looks like. It's from a previous video. It's just 5 records of some NBA players, their team, and whatnot. So we can see all this information here. Now let's see if we can query this same information, but from SQL Server. So let's run this query right here and see what happens. And there it is. We were able to get the same result set in SQL Server by querying Snowflake. So down here, I just have a few other examples of how you might want to do this. You know, maybe instead of having to always reference this, you could pull everything into a CTE and call it that way. So then, you know, anytime you use NBA players, you're actually referencing this table. You could add it to a temp table and now work with it this way. And just to clarify what's happening, as we said, this query is being executed here. So you're taking advantage at this point of the Snowflake processing power, and everything is being tied as if you ran it from here. Another thing that's pretty cool is that you can write other commands. It's not just select. Depending on your role and the permissions that you have, you can update the data as well. So we see this right here. Let's say we want to update Jimmy Butler to have a position of, instead of forward, to be test. Let's just say we're going to update. We're going to run it this way, update open query. And you know, it's going to select that database. It's going to return this model and we're going to set the position and just run a set statement. Let's run that. One row affected. So that actually worked. And let's try to select from here again. And there it is. Now let's also look here. Let's see, just confirm. And there it is. We're interacting with the same data, but from 2 different places. Getting back to those initial reasons why you might do this, you know, instead of having data in different places, maybe you're migrating, etc. You can see how this is really valuable in terms of keeping the data in one consolidated location, but still being able to reference it in SQL Server as needed. The last thing I'll point out is the query history. So if you go to history, and I'm looking at user, we can see here ODBC 2.231. These are all the commands, the queries that were run through SQL Server. So it's capturing that here. And we can see the select all. I just wanted to show that this is all here. Everything is getting its own query ID, and you can track it just as if you were running it here through this interface itself, because really it is very similar. The only difference is the interface that you're using, but it's still using the same compute, interacting with the same storage, but this time it's just being called through a SQL Server. That'll do it for this video, and hopefully now you can take this information and run with it however you need to based on your particular environment.